All right, as we've been doing throughout the last throughout this entire ordeal, we talk to people around the country, get their sense of what's going on in their states. We've talked to Bo Snerdly from the Rush Limbaugh show. We've talked to Sean Parnell up in Pennsylvania to find out what's going on in Western Pennsylvania. There's never been a more prescient guest than we have today. It's the Attorney General of the state of Louisiana, Jeff Landry. And we are expecting all the reports, all the doctors are saying that what's happening in New York is soon going to be happening in Louisiana. So we want to, first of all, send our thoughts and prayers to them, Mr. Attorney General, to all of you down there, and get a sense of preparedness and the feel on the ground right now. So thank you for taking the time today.
Thank you for having me.
You have about 3,500 cases right now in the state of Louisiana. You're taking precautions at this point. Before we get into any specifics, what's the sense? What's the feel of the people down there?
You know, I think as the stay home order worked its way into the communities around the state, I think you're starting to see people pay more and more attention to it and practice more and more social distancing. I went out yesterday and just kind of drove around and noticed that traffic was down tremendously, especially for a Saturday in the town that I live in. And you're seeing it more and more. Like I said, I think people are starting to recognize that this is a serious issue. It is a troubling pandemic, and it has consequences for people in the vulnerable population.
You issued a statement regarding price gouging, and there's a problem with price gouging. There's a problem with hoarding, particularly of crucial, critical medical supplies. As you guys have more of a telegraphing of this punch coming your way, is that becoming a bigger and bigger problem down there? People taking care of themselves first and things that aren't necessarily necessary?
Yeah, right now, since it began, we've had a total of 203 price gouging complaints. We've closed out about 134 of the 203. You know, what I'll tell you is that the hoarding, which you alluded to in your question as well, I think is to some extent a bigger problem, and it is kind of compounding the price gouging issue. You know, price gouging, for us to actually enforce price gouging, it's a subjective test, and the law is really unclear. There's a tremendous amount of factual evidence that we need in order to actually charge someone or to go after them civilly. But what we do see is that a restriction in supply. You know, it was like the run we had on toilet paper, right? I mean, if we had some law, I'm thinking that the legislatures around the state, around the country, should basically be discussing, after this is over, with hoarding laws, right? So that we ensure that the supply of needed items is going to be there. And of course, if you do that, I think that'll also help on the pricing side as well.
That's one of the things. There isn't a shortage of crucial things. There is, people are buying more. It's a demand thing much more than a supply thing. We're making the same amount of toilet paper we've always made, or probably ramped it up a little bit now. So when this is over, I think that there's going to be a bit of a reckoning, in the sense that the toilet paper industry is not going to sell anything for a while. People have a year's worth of toilet paper in their homes. I don't know how you feel about this, or maybe there's something you can say that can help calm people down, but that mentality of I must buy, it's here, I must buy all I possibly can. Grocery stores are still open. The supply chain is still rolling. Manufacture is still happening. And is there a way to reach people and make them, because I wrote a book about media manipulation, and I still fall prey to it. I know how it works. You watch one story and you think, oh, things are going pretty good. And then you watch another story and you think, oh my God, we're all going to die right now. The truth is always somewhere in between. But is there any way to reach people that you can think of that would make them feel better, that isn't unrealistic?
Yeah, I mean, look, what we're saying here in Louisiana is to basically continue shopping, but shop for a week, not for a month, right? The supply chain seems to be intact at this time. We have no reason to believe that it's going to be a problem. What's important is that we have to remain vigilant, but and not to panic. And I think that's the problem. The problem is the panic out there. And the way that we do it is basically what me and you are doing today is putting out good, solid, factual information for the general public to consume. What's happening out there, unfortunately, is that there's a lot of information, whether it's in other journalism sources that are trying to bend or basically hype up a particular story. We had a story here in Louisiana where we had one of our major papers basically put a big story out that a young lady, 30 years old, had collapsed in her apartment and died while waiting for the test. She had been tested for COVID-19. And they hyped it up, only to find out 3 days later that the test was negative, and she didn't even die of the disease and of the virus. And so those are the kind of things that we need to make sure that you and I put out good factual information. People know that there's not a run on toilet paper, like you said. However, I want to go back to something you said earlier. There is a shortage of medical supplies, right? Because of the demand, because of that supply chain is actually overseas. A lot of those medical supply devices or that equipment is manufactured in Asia and, of course, takes some time to get to the United States. So there is a shortage there, but on basic necessities that we need to be able to basically self-quarantine at home, no shortage.
One of the things that this necessity is the mother of invention. Of course, it'd be better to have a different type of necessity, but we're seeing around the country. On Friday's show, I talked with Mike Lindell from MyPillow, who has converted 75% of his manufacturing to making masks. Is there, and you see businesses that don't normally do certain things now, hours for the elderly. You can reserve a half an hour in a bookstore, for example, by yourself if you want to go out there. Are you seeing innovation like that throughout Louisiana where as businesses struggle in this time, finding new and creative ways to retain some level of normalcy?
Absolutely. I mean, look, the greatness about America is we're free thinkers, right? Because we're an independent bunch of folks. And yes, you're going to see that. One of the things that hit me, and it was a week ago, and I'm glad to see the type of intervention that you were talking about at the MyPillow factory I grew up in a textile town here in Louisiana that actually was relocated down to South America after the NAFTA agreement in the 90s and basically crushed the town. And what struck me is that, look, back then it was a Fruit of the Loom plant, right? And so the same material that you would use to make the surgical mask, you could basically make or could have made in that textile facility as well. And so it's great to see factories in the United States retooling and recognizing that we have a weakness or a weak link in our supply chain. And guess what? We're going to take care of it here in the homeland.
You had a situation down there with an abortion clinic that is refusing to close down, refusing to follow the guidance from the government. Talk a little bit about that. The argument they're making is it's crucial care that they need to stay open. We're seeing similar arguments in other states around the country where medical supplies, abortion is an elective procedure. Those clinics have medical supplies, masks, gowns, gloves, things like that, that are crucial to keeping people alive elsewhere. And they're fighting tooth and nail on one degree, I suppose I can understand it, but they're fighting tooth and nail to stay open and sort of keep their own supply from the frontline first responders.
Yeah, I mean, look, it's a typical theme in the abortion industry that they believe they're above everything and above the law, right? What we're telling them in Louisiana is that, hey, listen, there is no exception for abortion clinics. We're not treating them different in Louisiana than we are any other clinics. All the other clinics are closing. All the other clinics are doing their part to ensure that the supply chain, when it comes to medical equipment and protective apparatuses, are providing and going to the front lines of fighting this virus. the abortion clinic should be, it should be ashamed of them in the actions that they're taking. And we have sent a message to the Louisiana Department of Health, which is in charge of these types of clinics, and saying, hey, listen, we will help you to ensure that these clinics close.
Are the courts functioning down there right now that this order could be enforced? I mean, I don't understand or know exactly the situation there. Out here, they're functioning, but the skeleton crew. Is there a way to take defensive or proactive legal action in Louisiana that is efficient at this moment?
Yeah, I mean, we could. I mean, look, you're right. The courts are working in a limited capacity right now. You know, my hat's off. And a great shout out goes out to our Supreme Court justices who have worked extremely hard here in Louisiana to basically thread that particular needle and pass down good guidance to the lower courts so that we stay open, so that our criminal justice system continues to operate, so that our communities remain safe. So, yeah, there are some things that we absolutely can do. The sad part is that those in the clinics are only taking away resources and time that the rest of us have in trying to combat the virus, for us to have to go deal with them in what should be a common sense, responsible action.
Are there other industries or entities that are being bad actors in this time of need?
Other than them, I can't say there is. I mean, look, you know, one of the things I think we pride ourselves, certainly in Louisiana, we're a hardworking lot. And everyone out there is doing their part, like I said, to basically respect the social distancing, to ensure that the supply chain is open. You know, again, a shout out goes out to all the truck drivers out there who are keeping the grocery shelves and the supply chain open so that we have the things we need in order to self-quarantine. Of course, you know, a shout out to the doctors and to the nurses and to the paramedics that are out there on the front line. And so really and truly, I think things, for the most part, are working out well here in Louisiana. We've got a tough road ahead of us. The next 2 to 3 weeks are going to be bad for us here in the state. New Orleans seemed to be kind of a ground zero area for our state. You know, we can contribute that probably to Mardi Gras. And so, we've got a tough task, but I think everyone's up to making sure that we fight this invisible enemy and that we win.
Let's talk about New Orleans and Mardi Gras for a second. Mayor LaToya Cantrell was on television the other day talking about how she had no idea that there was this problem. She hadn't gotten any guidance. She definitely would have led had somebody from Washington told her to lead and shut down Mardi Gras. You're there. You're in the state. New Orleans obviously dominates the state in the news as the biggest city there. Was it a mystery what was going on in the rest of the world before Mardi Gras?
As far as I can tell, all of the news media outlets that we watch and the internet was certainly up and running over January through January and February in New Orleans. So I do believe the mayor was getting her news like everyone else. I would remind you that the mayor is part of the same political party that criticized the president for closing travel from Asia into the United States and basically said that he was taking premature action and basically calling him a racist for doing so. And again, what we found, though, was that the action that he actually took was responsible. But again, I would remind you that that was the same group that was calling and crying foul when responsible elected officials were actually taking actions.
Is there anything that Louisiana needs? Is there anything right now that you guys are desperately scrambling for? I imagine everybody's involved in, I imagine there are conference calls on a regular basis with all the relevant authorities, the governor, the mayors, the suppliers, things like that. What is there a critical shortage of? And how much have you learned from New York's experience, watching New York's experience in preparation for what they say, hopefully it won't happen, fingers crossed it won't, but what they say is coming your way?
Well, you know, unfortunately, the sad part is the need here in Louisiana is basically the need that you see in all of the hotspots around the country, right? We certainly will, you know, depending upon whether or not we can flatten that curve out or not, need ventilators, right? The more ventilators we could have in some of the critical areas, such as New Orleans, the better off we'll be. PPE, you know, the protective gear and equipment is absolutely in short supply. The K95 masks, of course, are in short supply. We hear that again and again and again. I have nurses that would call me and say, you know, we don't have all of the PPE that we need. And, you know, what should we do? And I'm like, well, you keep doing what you're doing right now, because some and having it is better than nothing. And so, again, you know, until we can fix that supply chain, until we can get more manufacturing capacity here on the homeland, we're just going to have that problem.
One of the things we've seen around the country is, as this spread, the waiving of federal regulations, the waiving of state regulations and local laws regarding, like, delivery of alcohol along with food, things like that. It's not really a problem in New Orleans. But in Louisiana, have there been things that I assume the governor would call you up and say, I need to waive this regulation. How do we do this? We need to bypass this law because it's an emergency need. Have there been things where the government is putting unnecessary regulations and such to the side?
I haven't seen. We got a couple of instances under which they actually created a regulation, the emergency rule, that became more problematic than before. But that was, you know, one example that I can think of. For the most part, we seem to be doing the same thing, which is cutting the regulations and cutting the rules out there so that the economy can move and that people can act in a much more efficient, effective manner. We did a lot of great things. Louisiana is unique. Of course, the number of natural disasters that we consistently have had over the last decades, we've got a lot of great laws on the books that deal with immunity, protecting people in these conditions from, you know, lawyers suing them after the fact. The governor has a tremendous amount of power to waive just on his own through executive order rules and regulations. The legislature under the Constitution has the ability to suspend laws for a time period. And so we've got some good arrows in the quiver in order to handle this. And, you know, like I said, for the most part, I think we're doing a fair job.
You mentioned the natural disasters you guys have had. Katrina, of course, being the most notable. It's a major city on the sea, below sea level. It's completely different. But what was helpful from the natural disasters you guys have faced to this pandemic?
Well, I think, you know, one thing, it's interesting. I've had that discussion with many of our emergency preparedness officers out there. And it is fundamentally different, right? These pandemics are absolutely fundamentally different than natural disasters. However, the key components out there, like I said, being able to have government function during a time of chaos, right? I guess the one underlying common factor is the chaos that ensures throughout the public. And it's just a disruption of normal and everyday life. You know, the good news, I guess, if you look for the positives, in this type of pandemic is that the infrastructure is in place, right? Our roads are still passable. Electricity is still on. We have clean water. Our supply chain is working. Now, on the flip side, you know, we're dealing with trying to ensure that the healthcare system can adequately cover the number of patients that are coming in. And that's the challenge.
How are you guys handling that? Are you creating new hospitals, these sort of pop-up hospitals, as they say, working with the Army Corps of Engineers? Or how close to capacity are you guys? I mean, it's a game where you want to keep it at bay. Are you guys staying far enough ahead of that wave, do you feel, at this point?
Well, no one has a crystal ball, but that's kind of where we think we are. I know right now down in New Orleans, they are building additional extra temporary capacity for hospitals and medical care. And of course, New Orleans is kind of the epicenter of the outbreak here in Louisiana. We don't know. We're moving as fast as we possibly can. I know that we're still in short supply of ventilators, or we anticipate that if we don't get more, we certainly will have a shortage. And so, again, if we're able to get those in, those supplies in, and if our peak comes in later, like the later it is in the month of April, or even if the peak doesn't happen until May, the better off we'll be.
How have you found working with federal authorities? And I assume other states are coordinating with one another as well. This is probably the most cooperative governments have ever been with one another. They tend to, you know, butt heads against each other as far as who has control, who has the rights and things like that. This is one time everybody's pulling in the same direction. But are the lines of communication open? If you need something, how free are you guys and confident in being able to call somebody and get, not obviously the crucial things, but general things or advice? Is there a communication set up that is very satisfactory between the federal and the states?
Yeah, I got to tell you, you know, my hat's off and a big shout out to the White House, the Office of Intergovernmental Affairs, Doug Hozier, William Crozier, and them have been absolutely wonderful in ensuring that we have conference calls after conference calls where, like, we've had AG-only conference calls where every attorney general in the country gets an opportunity to go on a conference call. They actually put people from the CDC, the Surgeon General, on those particular conference calls, allow us to actually ask questions, and there is some dialogue back and forth. You know, I got to tell you, the administration has been superb. And again, I think the key is what you hit on earlier. It's communication, the ability to push up questions and then to get responses. Now, of course, sometimes we don't get the response as quickly as we would like it. But for the most part, I think everything's being responded to in a pretty orderly and efficient manner.
How do you do the job of Attorney General, the chief law enforcement officer in the state, when you can't meet with anybody? You can't go any. I mean, it's a weird situation where I imagine on a daily basis you have a fairly large staff. They're in and out of your office. You're in and out of your office, in and out of different meetings and courthouses and whatnot. That's all cut off now. How does the rule of law continue to, not that it isn't, I'm not saying it isn't, but I'm just curious how you find the mechanics of conducting the enforcement of the law from an office in your home, I assume, or someplace where you can't really leave?
Well, you know, one of the things that we did during my last administration, because I just got reelected last year, was one of the things we did when I first got into office was try to bring the office into the IT world. And so over the last 4 years, we have done a great job of being able to administer laptops and cell phones and VPNs to all our staff members and certainly all our crucial staff and essential staff at the Department of Justice here in Louisiana. Of course, for those bright lawyers that we have in the office that are converted, they're actually liking it, right? But with some of the more social ones, it's a little bit, unnerving. All in all, we have done a great job. Our directors, I talked to each one of the directors at least once or twice during the week. I've had a number of conference calls. I had one this morning. You know, and it kind of comes in flurries, right? The governor will take a particular action. There'll be a response from other elected officials trying to understand that. We try to kind of mend the two or kind of give them some guidance as to what exactly is happening. So for the most part, we haven't had a problem. We really haven't. And we're in constant contact with the court as well.
As far as the criminal justice aspect of it, there's a crime problem in Louisiana, like there are crime problems everywhere, and in New Orleans, like there are in major cities everywhere. Some jurisdictions are releasing people from prison, mostly nonviolent. Some are making mistakes. Crime still does happen. First of all, are you guys considering releasing people from prison in the midst of this? And secondly, what about people? Is the response time from police changed at all? Are the police still, are they prioritizing certain things? Somebody, you know, smashes your car window and you call into the police, you say, sorry, we'll get there eventually, but we can't really do anything. There are other more pressing issues. Like, talk about law enforcement, first of all, the prisoners, and then the actual enforcing of the laws during a time of a pandemic and sort of self-quarantine.
Well, I can probably speak for everybody except New Orleans. New Orleans seems to be a special place when it comes to that type of enforcement. But I can tell you, everywhere else, enforcement has not changed. In fact, I talk to sheriffs on a pretty daily basis. I am not far, nor are they, nor are the district attorneys, or would be the equivalent to everyone else, county prosecutors. Here we have parishes. None of them are for any releasing of prisoners or shortening their sentences. I don't know that anyone has been able to convince me that those that are in jail are safer on the streets in New Orleans than they are in the jails. I know that the sheriffs have put in place protocols that they believe can adequately handle any, you know, any outbreak that they would have in a particular facility. And so I feel comfortable and I'm hopeful that the governor's not going to take that kind of action where we start just trying to release people because of some leftist or liberal policy that they've been wanting to have. I think it's problematic. I think it only puts a further strain on our first responders who right now are working overtime to protect themselves and the community as a whole.
You're a Republican. Your governor is a Democrat, albeit a somewhat conservative Democrat. Has that been a factor at all in your communication with him during this thing? Is there traditional party headbuttings that have happened that, or is it now just it doesn't matter? We're all Louisianans.
No, look, I think it's been over a week now. Him and I did a press conference together with Coach Ogeron, the LSU head coach, and where, you know, I said to everyone in Louisiana that the governor and I are going to stand shoulder to shoulder in this. Him and I have probably spoken more during this crisis than we have over the last 5 years. And so, you know, I think we've got a pretty good open line of communication. This is about working to get everyone through this safely, trying to protect as many people as we can, and hope that the vulnerable population that's out there, we can minimize the deaths here in Louisiana. So, you know, where I stand today is the same place I stood a week or so ago, in that I'm willing to work with anyone, irrespective of their political party or their ideology, in order to make sure that we keep everyone safe.
As we wrap up here, Mr. Attorney General, are the people of Louisiana taking this as seriously as you'd like, or are they following the? We see people in Florida still going to the beaches. We see people in New York throwing potluck dinners for, you know, screw coronavirus, let's have a potluck dinner. There are always some people who don't take it seriously, but on the whole, you guys, again, I imagine the motivator is everybody's talking about what's coming your way, specifically New Orleans. So are the people stepping up?
Yeah, I think for the most part they are. You know, I did a radio show the other day with a caller who was complaining about the social distancing that some people are not respecting inside of grocery stores. And you know, I mean, at the end of the day, the government and neither you or I can fix stupid, right? And so what we try to do is again, continue to educate the public. We try to educate them and make sure that they understand, listen, if you're not feeling good, if you are sick, don't go out. You know, try to distance yourself. You know, spend some time. We want people to spend time outside, right? When the weather's nice, you want to spend as much time as you can outside. But again, you want to respect the distance that you are between people. Think about what you're doing, Washington. You know, the general, public sanitation rules that are out there and in place are the guidance. But I think for the most part, Louisianians are doing their part.
Lastly, Attorney General Landry, I just ask you what message you have for the country. It's a lot like a tsunami warning. That's where New Orleans, that's where Louisiana finds itself. There's been an earthquake off in the middle of the ocean. We don't know for sure that a tsunami's coming, but you have to prepare for it. We're all going through this tsunami in a certain way, one way or the other, but they're telling us you're going to be the epicenter of it. What can you say to the country, and what can we do for you?
Well, you know, one of the first things I would tell everyone is, look, remember, be safe, be vigilant, but don't be fearful and panic, right? I think sometimes the panic can actually exacerbate an already bad problem that we have. I think it takes common sense. And I think that the guidance that's been put out by both the federal government and the state governments are sound. If we social distance, if we continue to wash our hands, if we continue to limit the interaction that we have with one another, we will be able to flatten this curve out, and our healthcare system, which is one of the greatest in the world, I might add, will be able to handle it. You know, I tell people the message is, listen, this virus is not something the American healthcare system can't handle. It just can't be overloaded. And if we recognize that and respect that, we'll get through it.
I tell you about the hand washing. I'm feeling my knuckles right now. I feel like I've been prepping for surgery. I've never used lotion before, but I had to grab my wife's lotion because my hands are so scrubbed down. Every time I go outside, we have two small kids. So I basically set all my clothes on fire every time I step in the backyard so they don't even come back into the house. It's a little bit of paranoia goes a long way, but calm along with it is the difference maker. Attorney General of the state of Louisiana, Jeff Landry, thank you so much for taking the time today. And good luck and Godspeed. God bless.
Stay safe.